Tonight, an interview with the leader of the Conservative Party, the Prime Minister, John Major.
Are you aware that a good many of your supporters would like to see you leading the Tory campaign in a more forceful and dynamic way?
Well, I find it interesting that you should say that. I spend half my time being told by some people that I've suddenly become too aggressive, and half my time being told by other people that I ought to be more aggressive. I rather suspect in the midst of that I've got it right.
Who told you you got too aggressive?
Well, I rather fancy that a number of people have. But the important issue, really, is not just the question of style, it's substance. It's whether we're raising the issues that really matter to people in this election and that really matter for their futures. That's what the election's about. It's not about trivial incidents. It's about who governs Britain in the future, what their programme is, and what that programme will mean for the people of Britain.
Yes, but the remarkable impact of Mrs. Thatcher's very brief appearance on the streets of this country a week ago, or a few days ago, drew a lot of people's attention to what they see as the weakness of your campaign.
Well, I don't believe we have got a weak campaign. I think our campaign is extremely strong. I think if you had travelled with our campaign around the country, you would have formed that judgment yourself. Anyone who's been with us, who has seen the reception on the streets, would, I think, understand that. Anyone who's attended any of our rallies, I think, would certainly understand that.
What has happened to the soapbox you used to speak from in your younger days in Brixton? Couldn't you bring that into play somehow, in the manner of addressing the people?
Well, in a sense, I am. The rallies we've had, of course, are set-piece speeches, but I've also been more open to answering questions, I think, than any other party leader in this campaign.
But what I'm getting at is it good enough to put across what you believe are sensible and wise policies for the country? Is it good enough to put them across in a nice, reasonable, mild-mannered and quietly spoken way?
I think people in this country want to be convinced. They want to know what someone stands for, what their policies are, what they would mean, and how they would carry them out. I don't think politics by invective and insult are the way to get a message across to people about their future. This election campaign, one way or another, has gone on a long time. Labour Party started at the moment the Gulf War ended. Oppositions do. I make no criticism of that. But we have to discuss the substance of what it means for people. Our education policies, how we'll carry health forward, what we'll do on defence, Europe. These are matters that need to be discussed in detail. It's people's future at stake.
But is it not the problem that some people, some Tory supporters, don't yet understand what John Major does stand for? What sort of Tory is he, they ask? Is he Thatcherite fish or Heseltine fowl?
Then ask me the detailed questions and all will become clear.
All right, but I'll ask you a question about Europe.
But I think people do know that, do.
Are you in favour of the Thatcherite vision of Europe, namely a Europe of independent nation states, or another Europe, a federal Europe with a single currency, a single central bank, and therefore a single government?
Well, I've dealt with this matter in my speeches. I've been dealing with it and I'm happy to deal with it again. I don't believe a United States of Europe is the right way ahead. I do believe a Europe bound together closely, a Europe of nation states bound together, is the right way. And not a narrow Europe with a girdle thrown round the rich countries of Europe. I do think we have to open Europe up, open it to the north and bring in the countries from EFTA, and then in due course, even more important perhaps, open Europe to the countries of the east, those newly democratic countries that were once part of the Soviet Empire. They've now got their own elected governments. They're searching towards a free market system. They want, firstly, some form of relationship with the community, and then, in due course, bring them in the community. Because there is a great prize to be had there. The greatest prize of the European community is not its economic advancement. The greatest prize is this. Twice in this century, Western Europe has been at war, and the whole world has been at war. Unthinkable that that could happen again. If we can open Europe to all those nations right the way across Europe, Hungary, Poland, Czechoslovakia, even Russia, we can do that. Perhaps not in my political lifetime, but when we manage to achieve that, we will have made the whole of our continent a much safer and more secure place than ever it has been before. And that's the sort of Europe I want to see.
Why does the Conservative Party deserve, under your leadership, what the British people have never given any political party in modern times, a fourth successive term of office?
I think because we have a vision for Britain that goes with the natural grain of the instincts of the British. What do people want these days? I believe increasingly they want more control over their own lives, more opportunity, more choice, more reward when they have performed well. That is the direction in which our policies lead. Perhaps I can put it this way. In the 1980s, Mrs. Thatcher made very remarkable changes in this country. She practically took a hatchet, carved her way through the undergrowth, and produced a path towards opportunity and choice. But we need to widen that path. I want more people to pass down it, become home owners, have their own pension, have their own choices, have their own freedoms. And then when they build something up in their lifetime, have to, yes, have to the opportunity to pass it on to the next generation. That's what I want to see.
That is all very well, but will that answer cut much ice with the unemployed, the homeless, those who've suffered repossession, and the many bankrupt businessmen who feel betrayed by the policies of your government?
Who are the people who are going to gain most from a successful economy and the expansion of choice? The people who will gain most are the people who at present have least. That is the that's what I've called a classless society. To expand a society of opportunity and choice, to bring more people in it, to expand that path of opportunity Mrs. Thatcher started and make it wider and bring more people in. Hence, originally, the policy of selling local authority houses to make more people homeowners.
Why is there no...
And the extension of those policies that we now have.
Why in your election programme is there no emergency crash programme of public works to build homes for the homeless and to provide jobs for some of the unemployed?
Because it's in the public expenditure programme. What people concentrate on when they look at the budget just a few days ago, they say, well, why did you make tax cuts? But what they have neglected to look at is the public expenditure plans which were agreed in November but come into force in April. And they expand public expenditure very dramatically and in key areas on housing, on health, on education. And there's an increase of over three times as much on public expenditure in their areas as there is a reduction in taxation in Norman Lamont's budget.
May I put to you a remark made by Dr. David Owen in one of his few speeches in this campaign? He said, you, the Prime Minister, are not the architect of the recession. He conceded that. But he said, you should admit that the depth of the recession in the UK is due to serious misjudgments by Lawson and Thatcher during 87 and 88, when, if I may remind our viewers, you were a senior Treasury Minister.
I was Chief Secretary. I was responsible for public expenditure at that time. But there is nothing new about that comment, for I've said it myself. In the wake of the stock exchange crash, everyone thought, including the government, the Labour Party, industry, TUC, that there was a danger of a slump, not just here, but around the world. And in this country, and in other countries, people then reduced interest rates quickly to avoid a slump. In retrospect, but only in retrospect, that was a mistake. And I think it is to that point that David Owen is referring. And I agree with him about that. We've said that repeatedly.
Why not a further cut in interest rates so as to jerk more life into the economy and to help you in the election?
Well, we have reduced interest rates by... I'll come to that point. We have reduced interest rates by 4.5% in the last 16 months or so. When it's appropriate on the foreign exchange markets, further reductions may be made. But there are several ingredients that are necessary to build a prosperous future. And I think there are three I would mention. One is the lowest possible inflation, nil inflation when we can get it, and that's my target. Secondly, a stable exchange rate. I don't want the exchange rate falling because it sucks in inflation and puts prices up. And the third is the right sort of economic climate for investment. That's what's necessary to deal with the problems of the people who are unemployed. We need the sort of society that will create jobs and give them not temporary jobs, but permanent, sustainable jobs with a proper career pattern that they can be proud of and can depend on.
But
can't be done overnight.
But
can only be done this way.
But, Prime Minister, why should you expect the people to trust your economic judgment and your economic management when they remember the colossal fiasco of the poll tax?
When I first became Chancellor, I said that my priority was to get inflation down. Inflation was on a rising trend. It went up to 11%. I persisted, despite unpopularity. Inflation is now 4.1%. Underlying inflation in terms of producer prices is well below that. And there is not a single commentator who doesn't believe that inflation is coming down still further.
No, but
I kept my word on that.
But some commentators,
and I will keep my word on other matters.
Some commentators do say, and you will doubtless read this comment, that any fool can get inflation down if he's prepared to lay the economy on its back.
The one thing that lays the economy on its back is rising inflation. Labour Party, if I may remind you, in the 1970s had 27% inflation and still had a recession.
But that's a long time ago, Prime Minister. Could we come back to the poll tax, which was the point of my last question? How can people trust your judgment when they remember this appalling I won't use the word I came to my tongue, but you know what I mean.
I think I know what you mean. When a government makes a mistake, there's one thing it can do, change it. The first thing I set in train when I became Prime Minister was the replacement of the community charge with the council tax. Not only did I say I would do it, I have not held a general election until that is on the statute books and we have a new system for local government taxation. I promised I would do that, and I have done it.
Do you agree with what Nigel Lawson said, that had we joined the ERM, the exchange rate mechanism, in 1985, that's several years earlier than we did, the boom in the late 80s would not have been so great, nor the recession so prolonged as it has been? Wasn't that another mistake?
I think it would have been desirable in retrospect if we joined the exchange rate mechanism earlier.
You shared in that mistake.
But I was not in the Treasury in 1985. But I was in the government in 1985.
In the following years, when we were still waiting for the time to be right.
But may I remind you that I'm the Chancellor who did take us into the exchange rate mechanism. I believed it was the right thing to do. I persuaded all my colleagues in government that it was the right thing to do.
Including Mrs. Thatcher.
All my colleagues in government that it was the right thing to do. All my colleagues in government. And Mrs. Thatcher and I took the sterling into the exchange rate mechanism. What? It was the right thing to do, and it has helped us bring inflation down to the benefit of industry and every individual in this country.
You mentioned Scotland, Prime Minister. Why are you so adamant against any measure of Scottish devolution? Because in 1976, 15 years ago, Mrs. Thatcher, Mr. Heath, Mr. Viscount Whitelaw, as he now is, that wise old Knight of the Thistle, said... I don't think anyone can deny that a directly elected Scottish Assembly, which is what they proposed, is consistent, he said, with the political and economic integrity of the UK. Why have you gone back on that policy?
What is proposed in Scotland at the moment by the Labour Party and the Liberal Party is a tax-raising assembly in Parliament. Follow the thought through.
But you're proposing nothing.
Let me follow the thought through and you'll understand why I feel so seriously about it, so deeply and passionately about it. If there's a tax-raising assembly in Edinburgh, in which they have sole responsibility for certain areas of policy, health, education, industry perhaps, that will have several effects on the Westminster Parliament. If Scotland had determined those matters solely for themselves, Scottish MPs could not come to Westminster and then decide upon the same issues for England, Wales and Northern Ireland. And what would that mean? That would mean two sorts of MPs at Westminster. MPs from Wales, Northern Ireland and England who could vote on everything, and MPs from Scotland who were second-tier MPs who could only vote on some subjects.
Are you saying that means you can't have any reform at all?
No, I'm not saying that. Just one moment. And that undoubtedly would mean at Westminster you are changing the constitution. A government couldn't be sure of its majority. And where would that end? What bitterness and chaos and frustration would that cause in Scotland? And if it did cause the bitterness and frustration, I suspect, would that not lead them to take the extra step towards separation? This is a dangerous and a slippery slope, the proposals for devolution that the Labour Party have.
But why don't you put forward better proposals for devolution?
Well, I'm arguing very strongly for the union. We've had a union
isn't inconsistent with devolution, as Viscount Whitelaw said.
The sort of tax-raising assembly that is proposed now is inconsistent over time with maintaining the union for the reasons I have just set out.
Why have you changed your mind on the desirability of proportional representation?
I never have.
Oh, but
I know exactly what you have there.
You
have a cutting, very probably from a Sunday newspaper,
no,
saying I was in favour of proportional representation. If you have, you would find they corrected it and apologised a week later, because what they had quoted was something I had said previously, that had been said previously not by me, but by my Liberal opponent at the general election.
So you've never wanted proportional representation, never thought it was a good idea at all?
I don't believe it's a
good
idea.
And you don't think you're going to have to talk about that after the election with Paddy Ashton?
No, it isn't a good idea. It leads to weak government. There are a number of governments in Europe who have proportional representation who wish they hadn't got it. They can't form their government. How long did it take the Belgians to form a government? 100 days. You can't run a country that way, a country like Britain. There are many countries with proportional representation who wish they had a first-past-the-post system in order that they have a strong government. I'm not in favour of proportional representation.
Under any circumstances?
Under any circumstances.
And you would under no circumstances cooperate with the minority party in order to maintain government?
I would not weaken our constitution for short-term party advantage of staying in government, no.
Will you resign as Prime Minister if you don't win an overall majority?
It's purely a hypothetical. I'm going to win an overall majority.
Yes, but all questions in an election are hypothetical, Prime Minister. What will you do if that?
Answer questions when they're reality, not when they're hypothetical.
Not in an election.
And in this circumstance, I can absolutely assure you that I am confident that we are going to win a clear overall majority sufficient for 5 years.
Of course, it's possible that God may smile upon the Labour Party.
I think the electorate will smile upon the Conservative Party.
What do you say to those people who think that after 13 years of Tory rule, it's only fair for the other team to have an innings in the interest of a healthy democracy?
This isn't a game of tag. It isn't a question of fairness. It's a question of who is going to run this country in the best way for the future of this country. I have no doubt that our policies are the right policies of this country, and equally I have no doubt that the policies the Labour Party have in mind would be a very dramatic step back into the past.
Why? Why a dramatic step back into the past?
Well, let me set out some of them for you. They would repeal the trade union legislation.
Not all of it.
They would repeal the trade union legislation, almost all of it, if not all of it, and they would offer fresh freedoms to the trade unions. Nobody wants to go back to that. They would have policies of much higher taxation rather than leaving more money in people's pockets to decide for themselves. They would stop the education reforms, the concentration that I believe is vital on the very basics of education, reading, writing, adding up. They'd go back to the old theories that have failed. They would stop the reforms that are making this a better and more efficient health service. They certainly wouldn't proceed with the strong defence policy that we have. They have a policy of cutting defence by 27%. And the Liberals now, I think of it, by 50%. So there are sharp differences. No one can be sure from one day to the next whether the Labour Party are in favour of being in Europe or out of Europe. They've changed their mind upon that matter 6 times.
Do you think that it would be a good idea, in view of the fact that the campaign is now getting rough and the polls don't look very good for you, though you think they're all over the place, do you not think it would be a good idea to reconsider your refusal to have a face-to-face debate with Mr. Kinnock and perhaps Mr. Ashton?
I'm having my debate with the electorate day after day and night after night. That's the debate I want to have. I want to put to them our ideas for the future of this country, listen to what they have to say, and persuade them that we have the right policies. That's the way forward.
So, judging by your description of the alternative which Labour offers, you don't just regard this as another general election, but as a very serious election affecting the whole future of the country and whether we make progress or go back. Most people don't quite see it in that way, do they? They think of it in terms of tax.
Well, tax is a very important matter, but the election's far more important than just about tax. Tax is vital, it is central. But there is a gulf between the two major parties, one of whom will form the government after this election. A gulf down a whole range of issues. I believe we have to build on what's been achieved in the 1980s. We have set out the policies to do that. I'm sure that's the way forward.
Prime Minister, thank you very much.
Thank you.